हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। आई होप यू विल फाइंड एट होम। सो टुडे बेसिकली आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन दिस लेक्चर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिक मशीन वन, दैट इज़ योर सब्जेक्ट सब्जेक्ट नेम। एंड इफ आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट द कोड नंबर एज पर आवर यूनिवर्सिटी करिकुलम, दैट इज EE205। हियर EE इज रिप्रेजेंटिंग द इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग एंड 2 इज इन द सेकेंड ईयर। सो सेकेंड ईयर मीन्स थर्ड सेमेस्टर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी। And the one more part is the electrical machine second, which we are going to study in the fourth semester. So the electrical machine one is basically comprising the two types of machine, rotating and non-rotating. Rotating we can say DC motor and DC generator, and non-rotating is a transformer. And what is a transformer? I think so you all know. A transformer is an electromagnetic device which is used to transfer one form of energy, basically the energy from one circuit to another circuit without changing its frequency. So I hope you understand that in a transformer, that is your unit number 5, basically we are going to study later on. So that is the transformer, and another one is the motor and generator. And if I am talking about the motor and generator, my dear student, so in motor we having basically the electromagnetic energy conversion. And in generator we having the same thing, that is electromagnetic energy conversion. But in motor, what we are going to do, basically we convert the electrical power into the mechanical power. And if I am talking about the generator, though in generator we convert mechanical power into the electrical power. So as per the thing, or basically as per the our subject, that is electrical machine one. So in electrical machine one, it is basically divided into 5 units as per the curriculum. So the unit number 1 is basically deals with the basic concepts. Now basic concepts, we can say that in basic concepts we need a coupling circuit, and coupling circuit, or we can say the intermediate circuit or the circuit which we use for the conversion purpose. So the conversion purpose we are using, what we are using, a magnet. A magnet is required. Why it is required? Because as per Bio Savart law, we can convert with the help of electrical power, we can convert by throwing that current into a coil, and it creates the magnetic field. So as per the Biot and Savart law, basically Biot and Savart law, we can say that if we flow a current in a coil, due to that current flowing in a coil, around that we found a magnetic field. So why the coil is using there for the generation of magnetic field, my dear student? Because in a coil we having turns, and in the turns, if current flow in the turns, that it meet with the turns, so we'll get NI, that is ampere turn. And if we having the reluctance in the whole circuit, then NI by S, we can say the MMF per reluctance, we can say the magnetomotive force per reluctance, so we can convert into the flux. So as per the Bio-Savart law, we are getting the magnetic field which is surrounded by the coil. So as per the magnetic field and as per the all these things, basically what we can do, we can generate or create magnetic field. Now if I am talking about the magnetic field, my dear student, because it is a coupling circuit in motoring or generating action, or in a transformer action, we can say machine action. In a machine we need a magnet, because we want to convert electrical to magnetic and magnetical to electrical, though I need a conversion part, that is known as the magnet, or we can say the magnetic circuit. So in the unit number 1, we have studied about the magnetic path or magnetic circuit. Then magnetic circuit we have 2 things. One is the magnet, another one is the magnetic field. So if I am talking about the magnet, so magnet are of 2 types. One is the permanent, another one is the temporary. If I am talking about the permanent magnet, the permanent magnet always persists the magnetic field whenever you want, whenever you apply. Basically apply means if you are applying a magnet in for in the nails, it can easily found that in the north side or south side it attracts. So opposite poles attraction, same poles repulsion. We have already studied in this thing, and we have already basically visualized this thing in the unit number 1 by the bar magnet. In bar magnet we having north and south pole, because each magnet or every magnet we found 2 poles, a dipole. We doesn't found any one single pole, we always found dipole. So in a magnet we having 2 poles, north and south. So north pole and as well as south pole we always found in a magnet. And how it works, basically north attracts the south and south attracts the north, you can see this. Okay, so this is the thing we basically studied in the unit number one. Then we having the in magnetic field, we can say flux is the denotion, or we can say denote the magnetic field. Flux lines is similar to the current, which is the flow of charges, rate of flow of charges in the electric field, is the representation basically. And flux line we have, it is represented by phi, the unit is Weber. And if I am talking about the flux density, so that is represent the B, that is represented by the B, alphabetical B. And what it is, it basically how much flux dense in a field, in an area. So that is given by flux per area. You can say Weber per meter square. Here we having the MMF also, that is the MMF is equal, MMF is ampere turns. Ampere is the current, unit of current, and turns we already have in a coil. So current, coil turns meet with the current, we having the NI, that is ampere turn. So ampere turn is the basically the expression for MMF. And if we having the reluctance in that core, then MMF per reluctance we get what? We get a flux. So I hope you understand the flux, flux density, MMF. Permeability is the measurement of flux, magnetic field in a circuit. That is the basically permeability. Now, one thing is remaining, that is intensity. Intensity is basically the MMF per lamp. MMF per lamp. We can say the ampere turn. What we can say? The ampere turn per lamp. Okay, then ampere turn per meter. So I hope you understand this thing. That is the intensity. The permeability is basically the measurement of how much the magnetic field can take place in a material. Now this is about the magnet, but magnet are of two types. One is the permanent, always persistent magnetic field. Another one is the electromagnet. If I am talking about the electromagnet, so we can make electromagnets by the help of the current. If we flow current in a coil, then turns meet with turns, the current meet with the turns, that is the MMF. And if we having the MMF in a field, so we having the reluctance. Because every magnetic path, or every, we can say, like just like your conductor. Conductor having the resistance tends to zero, but having the resistance. And if I am talking about the magnetic material, though magnetic material always having the reluctance. And what is reluctance? Reluctance is a property of magnetic material which opposes the creation of flux. Now it is similar or analogous to the electrical resistance, the resistance which resists the flow of charges. So that is the resistance. So similar to that, reluctance in a magnetic field, resistance in a electric field. So we can make permanent, we can make electromagnets with the help of ferromagnetic materials. Now, what are ferromagnetic materials? Basically, we can say iron is a having the ferromagnetic material property in which we can generate magnetic field. We can use iron for the magnetic core, ferromagnetic core. We can say the magnetic core. Okay. Then we having the nickel. Then we have the cobalt. Then we having the steel. Then we having the steel sheets. Then we having the metals. Then we having the alloys of it. So many things we can make ferromagnetic material. Now, then we make it, then we make a circuit. So, circuit are of two types, series and parallel. So, similar to your current, similar to your electrical circuits. In electrical circuit, if we're talking about series, so in series, the current remains same, but voltage changes. So, similar to that series magnetic field, flux changes, okay, MMF remains, and flux not changes, MMF changes. But if I'm talking about the parallel, current changes, voltage remains same. So in magnetic field, flux changes, but MMF remains. So this is the basic concept we having in the magnetic field. So magnetic circuit and the magnetic field, we have understand about this thing. Then we having so many laws, which basically says that we can generate, create EMF with the help of magnetic field. And we can also create a force when we interact the magnetic field and the electric field. So that is the force law. In force law, we can say a current carrying conductor plays in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. That is the basic principle, we can say the electromagnetic induction of DC. Okay, then after this, we having the Ampere circuit law, then we having the Faraday law of an electromagnetic induction. Now, Faraday law of an electromagnetic induction tells you what? It having two parts, consists two parts. One part tell you about the whenever there is a change of flux linkage in a circuit, then there will be induction of an EMF. If that circuit is closed, then induced EMF converted into the current known as induced current. So induced current and induced EMF, we can see. Okay. Then we have studied about the basically second law, second statement of second law says the magnitude of induced EMF is always proportional to the flux linkage variation. Okay. Now in unit number 2, we have understood about the electromagnetic force. Now if I am talking about the electromagnetic force, the electromagnetic force is basically whenever there is a current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field. For example, this is the current carrying conductor placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a force. That force is the experience means force is applying on it. So if force is applying on it like this, it moves. So if it is moving, so it means force applying and displacement is there. So we can say F cross T. That is the basic formula for the torque. So we can say torque is applying. So Lorentz force, that is Bill. We are finding, we find in the motor action also. So that force we having, then due to this force, we having the torque. And what, when the force take place? Basically force take place when it is perpendicular to the velocity of the flowing charges and the induced current is, we can say the velocity of flow charges and the magnetic field, basically represented by B. So I hope you understand. So the unit 2 deals with this all. How can we make it? How can we realize in a motoring action, closed loop, open loop, in a relay, in a galvanometer? So these all are the applications. So we have studied this thing in the unit number 2. Now in unit number 3 is basically the continuation of the unit number 4. We can say the basic part of unit number 4. Now in unit number 3, we have studied about the DC machines. So DC machines are basically, we are talking about the rotating DC machines. Because transformer is a non-rotating machine and it is part of AC. Because we give AC input, not DC. Okay. But if I'm talking about the DC machine, so it means I'm talking about the motor and generator. So as per the DC fundamental, we can say DC machine can be work as a motor, as a generator. Because construction is same. And if we are giving input mechanical, we will take electrical output, though it is a generator. And if we are giving mechanical electrical input, and taking mechanical output, that is motor. So motor is a DC machine which basically convert the electric power into the mechanical power. And generator is also an electrical machine which basically convert mechanical power into electrical power. So in generator, we give the prime mover, we connect the prime mover, which give the input in the form of mechanical. And through the terminals, we can say we take out the electrical power. But in a motor, we doesn't give any mechanical input, we give electrical input to the armature, rotor, and we take out the mechanical output with the shaft. So basically, these are the basic concepts. But if I'm talking about the basic laws, basic principle of operation, so motor works on the electromagnetic interaction, and generator works on the Faraday law of an electromagnetic induction. Now, in generator, we use Fleming right hand rule, but in motor, we use Fleming left hand. We can say the motor in motor we are giving the electrical input. So in that the armature rotates in the anti-clockwise direction. And if I'm talking about the generator, so I'm giving a mechanical input, so it rotates in the clockwise direction. So if I'm talking about the generator, it rotates in the clockwise direction. If I'm talking about the motor, it rotates in the anti-clockwise direction. But my dear student, the construction is same. If I'm talking about the construction, the construction is same. We are starting from the first part, that is known as yoke. That is known as yoke. Yoke is the, we can say the main part or main thing, main part which basically do what? It consists all the equipment. It carries the all the components of the machine. And it carries the flux also. Okay. Then we having the field. Field is basically the static part. And why I am using the word field here? Because it creates the magnetic. Okay. So it creates the magnetic field, that is why I am using the word field. So field having the pole, because I want to make a magnetic pole. I want to make electromagnetic pole. So if I want to make electromagnetic pole, do I need a core that is made up of ferromagnetic material, either iron or steel. In lower machine, iron. In heavy duty machines, steel. So we can say pole core, we can say. Now if I want to create, generate or induce or produce electromagnetic flux, we can say, so I need a coil. So that is the field coils or field magnet. It is a former bond. Former bond means if it is of rectangular structure, do I need a rectangular core or a piece on which that is made up of ferromagnetic material, and we can place winding on it. If I flow a current in, so as per the Bayes' law, we get a field flux. So that is the field flux. So we having the field pole, pole core, pole winding. Then we having the pole shoe. Pole shoe is just like this. It plays like this. The shape of pole is like the pole core, and shoes having the higher dimension, higher area. And why it is so? We also called as the pole piece. Why it is of higher area? Why it is of large area compared to the pole core? Because the reluctance is inversely proportional to the area. If I am increasing the area, I am decreasing the reluctance. If I am decreasing the reluctance, I am increasing the area. That is the thing what we want for the flux distribution. We can say another. So pole face, pole shoe, pole core, pole winding. All these things are there. Then we having the another part that is known as the rotating part, that is armature. And why we are using the armature? Because if I am talking about the motoring action, though I need to rotate something shaft, again that is motor, that is the armature. And in a generator, we want to do what? We want to basically do what, my dear student? We want to give the electrical output, wants to take out the electrical output. So how I get the electrical output? I get the electrical output with the help of Faraday law of an electromagnetic induction. So in Faraday law of electromagnetic induction, that is the basic principle of generator. So as per the Faraday law of electromagnetic induction, if we vary the flux lines, though I need a some part, we can vary the flux by two ways, either rotating or either stationary. So static EMF or dynamic. Dynamic means we need a coil which cuts the flux, and static is it is of the nature of alternating. So we can find static EMF in the transformer and dynamic EMF in the DC machine, either motor or generator. So these laws we can apply. So we need an armature, that is the rotating part. So in armature we having these slots, parallel path, and we place winding on. That winding is basically going playing an important role because they carries the current. When rotor rotates, it cuts the flux, and if it cuts the flux, so it the EMF will introduce. That EMF carries by the rotor or armature conductors windings. The armature windings are basically made up of copper and aluminium. Aluminium is cheaper cost, so small machines we can do for the cheaper construction or for the cost cutting, we can say. So that windings is basically behaving like a conductor because each turn consists of two conductors. So for example, like see this, in this I am placing like this, I am placing the conductor like this, winding one turn. So if I am placing winding one turn like this, so this is also conductor, this is also conductor, but turn is one. So one turn consists of two conductors, so that carries the current. And if I am talking about the DC motor, it is Fleming left hand rule, and the generator it is Fleming right hand rule. Though all the both cases, the current direction is like this. Now in motor, it is rotating in clockwise direction, but in generator, it is rotating in generator, we rotate the rotor or armature in the clockwise direction. But if I am talking about the motor, it is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. So clockwise or anti-clockwise, both the directions, the current is changing. Now see, because as per the Fleming right hand rule, this shows basically the thumb showing you the force, magnetic field, induced EMF. Similar to that, induced EMF, magnetic field, and force. So this rotate, this is clockwise, this is anti-clockwise. So both the cases, if I am getting the current, it is basically bad action. It is working like in a loop, positive, negative, just similar to your AC winding. But my dear student, if I want to, if I am teaching or delivering that, we are talking about DC machine. So output will be the DC or not? DC. So I need a part that which converts alternating current, or we can say the bar direction current, to the unidirection, that is known as commutator. And commutator is basically follow the process of commutation, in which we can do the reversal of current. And we can also improve it by the help of carbon brushes, mean increasing the resistance. And secondly is, secondly is the interrupt. Okay, I hope you understand this thing. Then we having commutator and commutator lugs. It is like this. It is made up of copper, and we connect the armature winding with the help of copper lugs. Okay, with the commutator segment. So commutator carries the current and it gives the output. So that output we have to carry and give to the terminals. So I need what? I need brushes. So in armature, armature slot is there, armature winding is there. That winding is in the form of lap and wave. Lap and wave, parallel connection and series connections, we can say. So lap is basically how we are making the connection of winding. Winding, armature winding is made up of copper and aluminium, my dear student. But in which manner I want to place, that shows you the lap or wave. Okay, and if I'm talking about the field winding, that is a former one. So that is the winding. Then we have in the armature core made up of, again made up of iron or steel, and we have in the slots parallel path, so armature slots and armature winding. But both cases, we if we talk about field or if I'm talking about the armature, though we having the losses, we having three different losses. First is the copper loss, that is I square R, though we having in both cases, in field, in armature. So armature copper loss and field copper loss. Okay, then we having what? We having the basically magnetic core or iron losses, because the we can say the core is made up of iron, so the losses take place in iron. We can say the core, that is core loss, it is of magnetic loss and iron loss. So that is the what? That is the basically your, if I want to remove or reduce the copper loss, I need highly inductive winding, low resistance winding. Because it is I square R. So R become having R value zero. So we can say I square is there 2 square into 0.5 instead of 1. So we'll get the less value compared to the 1. And in 1, it will be 4 watt. But if I'm talking the 0.5, it will be your 2 watt. So the resistance value decreasing the copper loss. So we can do this. We can do this by taking the highly inductive or inductive windings. Because purely inductive is the ideal case. So we can't get it the purely inductive, but we can say if I'm talking about the inductive winding, so highly inductive we can use, but not purely inductive. So I hope you understand. Okay, then if I'm talking about the windings, we having lap and wave, that is the series or parallel connections. Okay, lap we having the like this, and parallel we having the, we can say lap is like this, but wave like this. So A is equals to the armature slot, but in if I'm talking about the lap, so in lap we having A is equals to P, but if I'm talking about the wave, the A always equals to the 2, always equals to the 2. I hope you understand. So this is all about the basically the armature we have. Then we have the commutator windings or commutator lugs, basically components. Then we need a brush. That brush carries the current and flow it to the terminal, where we get the output, electrical output. So we need brushes. So if I want to improve the commutation, though I need the brushes made up of carbon or graphite instead of copper. I hope you understand. Then I'm talking about the losses. So our losses are of, if I'm talking about the magnetic losses, though in magnetic losses, we having two losses. One is the eddy current, another one is the hysteresis. So eddy current can be reduced by the help, by the make laminations with insulations. Mica and varnish within it. So with the help of lamination, we can reduce the current, leakage current value, that is eddy current. And if I want to reduce hysteresis loss, that is reversal of magnetism, BH curve, we have understood in the unit number 1 and in unit number 2. So we can reduce that in reversal of magnetism by using the silicon contained steel. 5 to 7% silicon content is basically improve the equilibrium or magnetic saturation point. So we'll get the density intensity with the relation of permeability, that is B is equals to mu H. So that we'll get. Okay. Then we have in the mechanical losses, we have in the friction and windage loss. Friction means if brush is connecting or the commutator segment. So if it is rotated, the brush will basically due to friction, it remove its initial position. It basically changes initial position. So though what I have to do, I have to basically maintain it. The maintenance is there. We have to change the brushes after the every maintenance period. So that is the friction loss. Basically, windage is basically the combination of wind plus H. So wind is there because if I am rotating, the friction is there. Anti-air we have, and the age is basically we connected with the long time. So wind plus H, windage loss. So three type categories we have: copper loss, I square R, magnetic iron or core loss, eddy current and hysteresis, then with the mechanical losses, friction and windage. So all three losses we have, we can remove it. Now commutation I told you, then we have in the armature reaction. Now what is armature reaction? Now see, in our armature we having again a winding in a core, so that also behave like a magnetic field. It create the flux. So the armature flux is moving like this, but the field flux is moving. The field flux is like this, but armature flux is like this. So we can say both are having the different field. So the armature flux distort the main field flux, which we want basically. We are in a need of that. So that field flux is basically distorted by the armature flux, is known as armature reaction. And armature reaction we can improve by the two methods. Means armature reaction we cannot improve. Commutation we can improve, but armature reaction we have to remove it, eliminate it, reduce it. So by the help of compensating winding connected directly with the armature to mitigate the problem, to basically compensate the flux which is produced, which is generated by the armature. So that is the compensating winding. Then we have the interpose for generate maximum flux, field flux. I hope you understand. Okay, then we basically derived the EMF equation, that is phi is in P by 60, where phi is the flux and is the revolution, rotation, speed of the armature. Okay, then we have in the armature conductor denoted by Z, P is the number of poles, A is the number of parallel path in our armature. So phi is in P by 60, we can see. Then we have also derived the torque. Torque is proportional to EB into IA. Now, my dear student, if I am talking about the EMF, that is generating EMF, but in motor, it is the direction is opposite. Now, see, in a generator direction is like this, but in a motor direction is like this or like this, we can say opposite. So, what we can say, in generator, it is known as generating EMF, that is 5Zm P by 60A. But in motor, we also need this thing. That is why the construction is same. So, if I want this thing, so the construction is same. We can say though, if I'm talking about the motor and generator. So in motor, I'm giving the power, energy, voltage, current, and getting in the output torque, speed, rotation, revolution. If I'm talking about the generator, we are giving torque, rotation, speed, and revolution, and taking output in the form of power, energy, voltage, and current. Okay, so torque is basically proportional to EB into IA, because torque is due to the electromagnetic effect. Electromagnetic effect is what? It's basically the part of electromagnetical energy conversion. We have studied in the unit number 2, electromagnetical energy conversion. We can convert electrical to mechanical and mechanical to electrical, but we need a coupling circuit, that is the magnetic field or magnetic circuit. So torque is proportional to EB into IA. So EB is the back EMF, same value we are getting, 5Zp by 60A, and IA is the armature current. So in motor, I need a torque. I need a torque, and in motor, I am needing a torque, or I wanted a torque. I am in a need of torque. So torque is proportional to EB into IA, and EB is what? Back EMF. So back EMF we'll get from where? Back EMF is similar to your generating EMF, that is 5V/60. So this is the thing. Then we have understood about the types. So if I'm talking about the types, my dear student, though we are having two types basically. Separately excited, we are giving the separately DC source, that is the battery or rectifier output, and with the variable resistance, we can vary it. Then we are having the self-excitation. Self is basically we want to give supply to the field by the residual magnetism, remaining magnetic flux. So first part is the we connect the field winding in series with the armature winding, that is the series wound. Then we connect the field winding parallelly to the armature winding, that is shunt wound, and we connect both in a way, series and parallel. So we can say compound. So in compound, we have two, cumulative and secondly is differential compound. So these all are the types similar to the motor, similar to the generator. Okay. So this we have understood. Then this comes in the unit number 4, similar to the generator, similar to the motor. Then we understood about the characteristics. In generator, we having different characteristics. In motor, we having again different characteristics. So previous series of my lecture, basically, we have understood about the characteristic. It is depend on the characteristic, open characteristic, no load characteristic, magnetizing characteristic. Now, if I'm talking about the motor, then we having the torque and speed okay, we can say basically the speed torque into an armature current, speed and armature current, or we can say the flux. So this is all, but it's depend on the basis of the types are different. Basically we have in shunt, series and compound, so they are having the different applications, they having the different characteristics. Similar to that, in the generator we having different characteristic for self excited generator and separately in cell we having three: shunt, series and compound. So I hope you understand about whole this thing we have studied. Now today what I want to deliver you, what I want to teach you basically, that is the speed control methods of DC. It is very desirable thing, because if I want to control the speed, because I want to switch on or switch off the motor, so I want to do what? I want to control the speed of DC. So that is the important part. So how can we do? My objective is help the student to understand about the basics of speed control methods of DC motor. How can we do it? And make the students familiar with the different speed control methods of DC motors in detail. So moving forward, factors affecting the speed of DC motor. Now, what are the factors is basically, in my previous lecture I told you about the characteristics. So some relation was there, that torque is proportional to back EMF into IA, and torque is inversely proportional to the speed. So speed is inversely proportional to the phi, we can say. So the factor affecting the speed of DC motor, first is the flux, magnetic field. Second is the voltage across the armature, means current in the armature, applied voltage. Depending upon these factors, the various methods of speed control we have. If I'm talking about the flux, if flux is not there, though, we cannot say that we are getting the magnetic output, because whenever there is a current carrying conductor plays in a magnetic field. So magnetic field is representing by a flux, that is field flux, and voltage across the armature is basically the current carrying conductor, that is the armature. So armature is carrying the current, so voltage across the armature, applied voltage. Obviously depending upon these factors, the various methods of speed control we have. What are they? Now moving forward, depending upon these factors, the various methods of speed control are: changing the flux phi by controlling the current through the feedback. We can say changing the flux phi. Now see, we can say in a motor, it is the motor basic principle is Faraday law of an electromagnetic interaction. What it says, it is basically a force law. Okay, so current carrying is what is the armature, and magnetic field is basically generated by the field. So if we change the field, though the torque or force applied is also changes, so we can control the speed or not? We can. So changing the flux phi by controlling the current through the field winding and flux control method, called flux control method, is flux control method. Okay, field control, or we can say the flux control method. So in some books you will find the field control method, though don't confuse. Basically it is same thing, we having the field control or flux control are the same methods. Now secondly, changing the armature path resistance, which in turn changes the voltage applied across the armature, called elastic control or armature control. So we having two basic things. First is the field control, another flux control, another one is the we can say armature control. Though in field control we can basically change the field, we can basically interrupt the field flux generation, so we can change control the speed. Secondly, we basically connect some resistance, that is rheostatic control, in the armature. Though armature current reduce, though what will happen, the force is also reduced, the speed, the torque is also reduced, corresponding to that speed is also reduced. So we having flux and armature method, we can say. Now changing the applied voltage, called voltage control, that is the third method. We can say changing the applied voltage, we are changing the applied voltage, so that is the voltage control method. Now speed control of DC shunt, how can we get it? It is known as flux control method here. Now see, this is the armature we have. We having the brushes A1 and A2 positive. This is the resistance which is in the series, we can say. Flux control of DC shunt motor. If I am talking about the DC shunt motor, means the field winding is connected in shunt or parallel to the armature. So I am connecting what? I am connecting a shunt resistance. What will happen if I give the supply voltage or flowing the current? So current will take, current is basically reducing, and if current is reducing, the flux generation is reducing. If flux generation reducing, though the speed is also reducing. So that is known as the flux control method. Now see, we'll get the speed and the shunt current characteristic, that is the hyperbola form, we can say. Here it is, rectangular hyperbola form. So normal speed we are getting, it is in the inversely proportional, we can say. So that is what flux control method. What we are doing here, basically, we are connecting a resistance in series with the, we can say the variable resistance with the shunt. Okay, I hope you understand. Now, flux control method, advantages, an easy and convenient method, we can do. It is an inexpensive method since very little power is wasted in the shunt field used due to relatively small value of shunt. Because higher value of resistance and due to small value of shunt. We know, we also discussed about this thing. But if I am talking about the shunt, though in shunt we having the large shunt winding, that is means higher resistance. The speed control exercised by this method is independent of the load of the machine. We can do. Now this disadvantage, the thing is that only speeds higher than the normal speed can be obtained since the total field circuit resistance cannot be reduced below RSH, the shunt field winding resistance, we can say. So above the speed, normal speed. The speed, there is a limit to the maximum speed obtainable by this method. Maximum limit. The field of a shunt motor in operation should never be opened because its speed will increase to an extremely high limit. You can say high. This is the disadvantage. Now, armature voltage control. Now, what we are doing here is now see. It is the armature of the shunt motor, and this is the shunt field winding. So, what I am doing here, I am connecting a resistance with the armature. So, I am reducing the current which is flowing in the armature. So, if I am reducing it, though, what will happen? The armature current is reduced. So, we can say torque is proportional to EB into IA. So, if torque is inversely proportional to the torque. Inversely proportional to speed, the speed is controlling by the help of controlling the armature current. So we can do it. And we are getting the characteristic here, normal speed. So n is proportional to EB upon phi. We can say n is proportional to V minus IARA minus IARC upon phi. If IA reduce, then EB also reduce, hence speed is also reduced. Okay. Below rated speed only possible in this matter. Below, not above the rated speed. Below rated speed, we can do it. By this formula, we can do this thing. I hope you understand. Now, disadvantage. A large amount of power is wasted in the controller resistance since it carries the full armature in IA. The speed varies widely with the load since the speed depends upon the voltage drop in the controller resistance, which I am connecting, and hence on the armature current demanded by the load. The output out and the efficiency of the motor are reduced. So poor speed regulation. We are doing below the speed, so it is having the disadvantage more. Compared to the advantages. Now, potential divider control. What we are doing here? Now, in potential divider, basically we use a resistance, that is potential divider, and we basically connected and directly connected with the divider. So we are getting the control. We are doing the speed control. So that is this thing. Inertia to overcome, and I'm just disconnecting the armature with the supply directly connected with the potential divider. So the wastage. So we can also use in the braking purpose. Now, applied voltage control. So applied voltage control. Now see here, I'm basically applying the inner shunt resistance. I'm applying this armature and applying the voltage. So voltage, if I'm varying 0 to 20 plus 220. So if I'm varying, it means I'm varying the voltage in the armature. So I'm varying the current in the armature. So flux is varying. If flux is varying, though speed is also varying. So that is similar to flux control, but we are applying the applied voltage. Okay, I hope you understand. Now, speed control of DC series. Flux control, that is known as field diverter method. We can do what? Field diverter. Why I am doing so, my dear student? Because it is a series winding, series machine. So in series my machine, basically we connect field winding in a series with the armature. So if I connect the resistance directly, so it basically vary the current of the series field, series winding, we can say. So series field winding is shunted by a variable resistance RX known as field diverter. It is shown here. Speed control above the rated value. Now the speed control in which we can found above the rated value. And this is the speed and we can say armature current characteristic without RX and critical resistance RX, we can say. So with the RX, we can change it. So I hope you understand. Next is armature diverter model. That is armature control. So in armature control, what we are doing, we are connecting the resistance, that is RX, here. So see here, and here we have the supply voltage. Now motor which require constant load torque, armature of the motor is shunted by a variable resistance. The previously the field is shunted by the variable resistance. Here the armature of the motor is shunted by the variable resistance known as Rx, known as armature diverter. Here it is the field diverter, here it is the armature diverter. So speed control below the rated value. For example, 1500 RPM is the rated value, so it basically control below the rated. Now tapped field diverter. In tapped field diverter, we can say we do what? In field winding, for example, now I'm taking an example. So for example, in our field winding, we have 10 turns. So we can divide 2.5 turns, or we can say 8 turns are there, though 2 turns in a each tape. So we are getting 1 tape, 2 tape, and 3 tape, and 4 tape. So 4 tapes are includes 2 turns of that winding. So 4 into 2, 8 we are getting. So flux change is achieved by changing the number of turns. We can do it of the field winding. So speed control above the rated value. What we are getting? The speed control above the rated value. I hope you understand. Now series parallel connection of field we can do with the help of this. In this method, the field coil is divided into various parts. It is into the part, we can say tapping, we can say 8 turns, so 4 turns we are dividing, and we are connecting in the series 2 turns, and we are connecting in the parallel. So this is the thing, same thing. So in this method, the field coil is divided into various parts. These parts can be connected in series or parallel as per the requirement, as figure 4.1, this one A, and B show the two parts of field coil connected in series parallel. So this is the A part. In the armature, the series winding is connected, that is, you can say series ohm. In this, the series winding, basically we divide into two parts. 4 plus, we can say 2 plus 2, that is 4 turns. So we converted 2 turns separate and 2 turns separate. So this is connected in series. So resistance also changing. And here I am connecting in the parallel. So we can do the connection in the series. That is known as series parallel connection. Why I am doing so, my dear student, and why do we do this so? Because if you want to control the speed, though I have to do this. That is why. Now, rheostatic control. So variable resistance Rx is entered in the series with the motor. The voltage drop across the resistance, that is IERX, occurs. This reduces the voltage across the armature. So it is similar to that. That is rheostatic control and armature resistance I am using. I hope you understand. We discussed this thing before. So Rx, without Rx, the characteristics is there, but with Rx, the characteristics is down. So we are getting the rheostatic control with the speed and current. Now, applied voltage control. Now in applied voltage control, we can do this by this thing. A prime mover is there in the generated and generated field. We having the motor is connected with directly like this, because in the starting of this lecture, I told you that the output of generator will be the input for the motor, and output of motor will be the input for the generator. So output of the motor is mechanical, that is the prime mover which is connecting to the armature of the generator, and generator output is basically the electrical which will be the input for the motor. So the the voltage obtained by the generator is controlled by a field diverter resistance connected across the resistance, series field. Here it is, field diverter and field winding of the generator. Motor and generator, we can say. So if I am controlling the generator output, we can control the motor input and the voltage control, we can say. Now, in a series. Second, we can say the third method is the Ward-Leonard system of speed control. Now, Ward-Leonard is basically, we can say, it is the suggested by the two physicists or the two scientists, Ward and Leonard. In this, we having three machines. One motor, one generator, and two motor and one generator. So, motor-generator set is basically working independently. And basically dependency or each other means motor output is given to the generator input, and basically motor output is the shaft torque, and the generator output is the electrical which is giving to the fed, which is feeding to the motor, we can say. So two motors is basically controlling the third motor, we can say. So two motors M1 and N2 and one generator, that is G. So we having the motor generator set here. It is looking like this, and it's coupled like this, you can see. Yeah. And we are controlling the, what we are having, we having the motor and generator. So that motor is controlling the generator, and that generator output is controlling the second motor, we can say, with the field here shown by this diagram. Okay, so this system is commonly employed for elevators. We use for the elevators, hoist and main drive in steel mills, The modified world unit system is called world unit igner system, in the which a flywheel is used in addition to motor generator side. We can add we can generate motor generator, we can add the flywheel for the storage of things. That is the advance. So that is the world unit system. We use it. The disadvantage is very much in this world unit system. Now what are they? See, smooth variation of speed over the wide range, we can see. Rapid and instant speed reverse, we can work on it. Speed control above and below rated is possible. Having the speed control above and below rated is possible. Good speed regulation, we are getting the good speed regulation in this. Efficiency is low, that is disadvantage. Initial cost of setup is very high, and it basically provide the force, very much force. Why it is providing the how much very much force, my dear student? Because if I'm talking about the world unit system, so in this we having three machines working on a earth. It is placed on a it is placed with the foundation on earth, so it basically applying a force on the earth. Heavy machines, heavy duty machines working on it. So that is the disadvantage also. So we having the efficiency is low, initial cost of setup is very high, but advantages are smooth variation of speed over the wide range, rapid and instant speed reverse, we can change the speed. Speed control above and below rated is possible. Good speed regulation we have. Efficiency is low. Initial cost of the setup is very high. So that is the advantages and disadvantages. So we have understood about the speed control method, that is flux control. Basically connect the resistance in the field, connecting the resistance in the armature, that is armature control. And if I am changing the voltage, that is applied voltage. So rheostatic control, flux control, and applied voltage control. In which we are having the method, that is world unit method, that is the costly method, but we are using in the steel, we can say mills and all this. So I hope you understand about the whole thing. Okay, now the multiple choice question related to our topic, today's topic, that is the types of speed control methods of DC. A speed of DC shunt motor are controlled by flux control method, rheostatic control method, and voltage control method, and all of this. So my dear student, we have studied, we can apply all three methods on the shunt DC shunt motor. So the option is D. With the increase in temperature, the speed of series and shunt motor will increase, decrease, decrease, increase, 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 decrease, decrease. So we can say the series motor is decreasing, but shunt motor increases. So decrease and increase, that is the option number B. If a portion of armature current is diverted through the diverter resistance, then the speed of DC series motor remains same, increases, decreases, none of these. So above the rated speed, we can say we are fine in this. So that is the increases. A series wound motor is also called a universal motor. First, I want to tell you something, that torque is proportional to I square. So I square means we can use for the DC, we can use for the AC. That is what is known as DC universal motor. So it will run equally well using either an AC or DC motor. It will learn below speed, below and above rated speed. It can be used in all kinds of application, none of these. So option A is correct for it. In flux control method for controlling the speed of DC shunt motor, the speed control is not possible below normal rated speed, above normal rated speed, both A and B, none of these. So option is below normal rated speed for DC shunt motor. I told you in the first, we can say speed control method, I told you this thing, I taught you this thing. So in armature voltage control or rheostatic control method for speed control in DC shunt motor, a variable resistance is added in series with the armature, added in series with the field, connected across the armature, both in series with field and armature. So rheostatic control is basically I'm putting the connecting the resistance in the armature, that is in the series. So option is A. Which method is suitable for the speed control below and above the normal rated speed of DC shunt motor? Flux control, rheostatic control, voltage control, and all of these. So voltage control is good for us. If a resistance is added in series with the field winding, a DC shunt motor, then its both speed and torque increases, both speed and torque decreases, increases, speed increases, torque decreases, and speed decreases, torque increases. So option D, speed increases but torque decreases, this inversely proportional. World unit system is used for wide range of speed control, very sensitive speed control, both A and B, none of these. So both A and B, C option. For frequent starting and stopping and reversal, which motor is commonly used? Permanent magnet, world unit system, pressurized DC motor, all of these. So what unit we can do? It is very versatile and we can use very flexible. So option is B. Now, references are there in which through which I took some material to deliver this lecture. That is A. E. Field Garand and R. K. Srivastava, Stephen J. Chapman. So all these three books are very good, and you can also refer for your understanding this topic or reading or learning the electric machine one and two. Also, you will find in these books. So these are the very good books. You can refer it. We have available in our lab. So this is all more references we have. P.C. Sen, Deshpande, P.S. Bhimra, S. Sharma Pathak, U.A. Bakshi and M.M. Bakshi. So I took some material from these references also and other web sources we can see. Now, thank you from my side. This is all about the types of speed control methods, or we can say the speed control methods of DC motors. So I hope you understand this thing, and this is all about from my side. I hope you understand. So thank you for patience with me in this thing, and thank you from my side, student, that you have listened this thing, you have understood.